So, it's the time is just coming up to 6 p.m. It will be in a few seconds, and it's like waiting for Big Ben to chime. And as the clock strikes 6 p.m., oh, there we are. So, good evening, and welcome to the Teach Computing webinar. So, this is a 1 hour webinar where I'm trying to give you some little insights and ideas into ways of teaching computing and sharing with you lots of resources and some episodes from my teaching. I started teaching computing in the year 2011, and I don't have a background in computer science, or I didn't at that point. But I decided I was going to have to do this thing, and I'm going to have to learn how to do it. So, hello, everybody. And please use the chat. So there's a few names on there I've not seen before. In the box in the chat, you can type in something about yourself. You can say, hello, my name is Liberty. You can tell us where you are, what you're teaching. And I've got a little back channel going on there, so some of you can talk to each other as this goes along. I started recording a podcast about 2 years ago. I can scroll up. The podcast episodes are still there. There's nearly 300 episodes, just highlighting it there. And they're available from iTunes, so you can subscribe to them and you can listen to them. But that's where I was explaining how I started teaching computing. But anyway, so a couple of things to mention. So I try to share quite a lot of what I do through Twitter, and that can include photographs and links to resources. So you can get in touch with me through Twitter if you want. You might even send me a message now, but it'll probably be 7 or so before I reply. I write a blog occasionally where I post ideas and thoughts. But all of this is being funded through a project called Jam Packed. And Jam Packed is it's like a circus, really. It comes around visiting different areas around the north of England. So far we've visited Hull, which is over on the east coast. And last weekend we were at Eccles, which is a place near Manchester. And we've got lots more visits coming up from through January and over the next 18 months or so. And it's been funded by the Raspberry Pi Foundation, the UK Department for Education, the DfE, and RM, and there's a couple of other organizations as well that are also getting involved. And I'm going to explain a little bit more about what's been happening tonight in this webinar, and you can get like an idea about what Jam Packed is all about. But part of Jam Packed includes 28 free online seminars for computing teachers, and this is just one of them. I think this is number 7, so that means I've done 6 already. I'm just going to scroll very quickly to the bottom of the document because lots of people have been sending me questions this week on Twitter and that. How do you get access to recordings from the previous ones? So they're all there, they're just at the bottom. So, for example, if you want to go and look at the first one and see what happens, you just click on there where it says Monday, the 13th of October, and it takes you to another document. And that document, I'm not going to click on it because it might not work very well, but it takes you to clips on YouTube where I recorded it and explains, and each video segment takes you through to a certain part of the video that you can watch. And my plan is that this will be like build up as an archive over time, and then people can go back and have a look at things that happened. So tonight's session is being recorded. Now I have an agenda for tonight. I also have a new microphone because I'm trying to do what I can to try and improve the quality of these. So and I've got two computers. I've got one in front of me with a webcam, which I'm waving at now, like there's somebody looking at me, and I guess you're probably waving back. And then I have another one here, which I'm looking at on my right-hand side. That's my right over there, and that means I can watch what's going on in the chat. So I can see people saying hello, and there's Liberty's in Essex, teaching ICT for 7 years, and she's teaching O and A levels. Didn't know we still had O and A levels. And okay. So use the chat, type messages in, and if you want to ask questions as we go along, I think the best thing is if you type them into the chat, and I'll keep reading the chat as we move along. I'm just going to do something that's good. Okay. So what I've got planned for tonight, Monday the 8th of December, is I want to share with you a couple of things, some activities that we used in the last week or two, including jam-packed events. I've also I've started using some of the Hour of Code activities. I wasn't well enough on Thursday or Friday to come into school, so I had to set some activities for my classes. So I got them started on the Hour of Code a little early, and I've put them in a digest that you, I'll just show you what that looks like. And then I had a lesson observation on Wednesday afternoon, where that's where colleagues come in and they observe me and give me some feedback, which I've not had yet. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of an insight into how the lesson went. Susan put a message on Facebook saying she had a lesson observation last week as well, and she used some of the resources that I'd been mentioning in the webinar, and she got her lesson graded as outstanding. So she's now shared the link, the resources to that, so I'm going to mention that. Now, some people have been asking me about Little Man Computer, and what I'm going to do in a little while is give it a very brief intro to Little Man Computer, but I can go into it in more detail in the future. Just realized I haven't put a link into that. So this document that I'm using is a Google document online, and you can use it yourself. Gosh, I'll just paste it here. At any point, you can come back and view it and review it. And one of the things is there's a link to a form where you can submit questions. So Derek and Nikki both submitted questions since last, and I see that Derek's on there. So I'm going to answer Derek's question a little bit later on. In fact, Derek, if you want to just cut through to the to find out what happens in the at the end, you can just read down there, and you've got access to that now. So I'm going back up to the top. So until about 6:30, the plan is to share some kind of classroom insights, and then go on to teach computing at 6:45. Sorry, at 6:30. So jam-packed, the plan with it is, for a few years we've been organizing events in our school, and they have different names. So we have Raspberry Jams, Hack to the Future, and Family Hack Jams. And I found that they're all of those, they take place out of normal lessons, but they allow me to experiment and to try things that I wouldn't normally get to try in the classroom because it's not on the curriculum or it's not on the specification. So people from other schools, teachers have come along, and sometimes they've brought children from their schools along to these events as well. And I came up with this idea, which would be maybe instead of people coming to us, we'll go off on tour and we'll go around the country. Now, I live in the north of England, Preston in Lancashire. I teach at Our Lady's Catholic High School. And I didn't want to be like, I mean, traveling too far. And also, I noticed there was a lot of things happening in certain parts of the country. So we're really focusing on the parts of the country where not so much happens. Places like Hull and Darlington and Stourbridge and Leeds, and there's loads of other places we're going to as well. So last Friday and Saturday, me and some of my friends, we were in Eccles in Manchester at a school called Ellesmere Park. And during the day on the Friday, we ran a Hack to the Future event. So what we actually did was we provided five workshops that ran all day long, and the children attended our workshops. They were year eights, and instead of going to their regular lessons, they actually spent the day with us instead. So we had five workshops, which I've listed here. So one of these was run by a gentleman called Paul McKnight, and he's the director of Vex Robotics. And what looked amazing was, I'm going to click on some of the pictures just to show you. He brought along this robot arena and some robots, and it's in these photographs down here, so towards the bottom. So there you can see what the robot arena looks like. So we moved all the furniture around the side of this room, and the children had to they got to spend 1 hour in this workshop, and all of the children got to spend 1 hour in it in year eight. And there was various challenges. We had to program the robots to be able to carry out certain maneuvers. And what was really interesting was some of the children in the day that I'd struggled to engage their interest with text-based programming in Python, they were like different children altogether when they were in the Vex robotics session. And in fact, look, you can see there's a picture of Paul himself. And there was software on the laptops where the children were learning how to program. And once they'd programmed the software, they then would download it onto their robot and put it into the arena. Now, I didn't get to actually see an awful lot of it myself, only a few moments, because I was leading a workshop in one of the other classrooms. So So that's the VEX Robotics kit. So I've put a link in the document to VEX Robotics. You can find out a little bit more about it. I also had a friend of mine, Dave Ames. He came along and he ran an Adventures in Minecraft workshop with Raspberry Pi. So there's a link there to the book that has helped inspire Dave with what he was doing. So if I scroll slightly differently into that document, you can see in some of these photographs here, you can see this might just look like a child is using Minecraft, but actually these are all on Raspberry Pis. So there's some of my Raspberry Pis I've brought along, and there's like a VGA connector there. So it's connected into these screens that the school lent us for the day. And the children, they weren't just building things in Minecraft. You can actually see here that they've got IDLE open on their Raspberry Pi, which means that they can actually program Minecraft to do various things, building bridges and traffic lights and those. So the children would spend about an hour in the Minecraft workshop. And so there's some more examples of that. So I've put a link. Oh, there's the Raspberry Pis again. Put a link in the document to the book. I've got a copy of the book since. It looks like it's a really, really good book. It's got lots of ideas about teaching text-based programming through Minecraft. And it's a project for me over Christmas. I've got this notion that I could possibly teach all of the GCSE computing programming elements through Minecraft, and I'm hoping over Christmas to test that out when I've got a little bit more time at home. Now we had another workshop, which I planned this for myself. It's called Hacking with Pygame. And if I click on that, you can see it takes you to a document. I've been using these Mozilla WebMaker resources to plan these sessions. So there's a lesson plan there that you could use. And you can also remix it just by clicking on the remix button, and you can create your own version. So sometimes people are teaching Python or other text-based programming languages. It can appear to be very dry and heavy. And a nice way into that is actually to start off with something that's already working. So if you get the correct version of Pygame and Python installed on your computers, what you can actually do is you'll find there's examples of games that already exist. So during this activity, the teacher who delivered the workshop, so I'll just scroll some pictures there we can see. So these are some photographs of children in the Pygame workshop. So we had Pygame installed on these laptops along with Python. And there's some games that are already provided, like Wormy and Squirrel Games and things like that. And to begin with, the children just play the games just to see how proficient they are. But then they start to hack the code. They start to make some changes to it. And they've used the whiteboards here to come up with various theories about what the changes might do. The squirrel game. And by changing elements of the code, they can actually affect and change the behavior of the game. Now, I'm not really set up very well to do this, but I'm going to see if I can run a little bit of a demonstration. I'll move the microphone over to the side. This, I tried doing this in a different way earlier. It didn't work quite as well as I would like. So, this is the other PC. Look, here's my hand here in front of the camera waving. This is the other PC. And on this PC, if I just minimize this for a moment, minimize this as well. And I'm using Python 3.3.2. And I go to Options, Configure. What I can do is I can increase the font size. 22 and bold. So now that it might be a little easier for you to read what's going on my screen, although I just have to sort of trust that you can see it. Angle the microphone this way as well. So what I've done is I've got the Wormy game here on this particular computer. There's a book online, inventwithpython.com, and there's a Pygame book. So I've downloaded the book and all the games that go with it. Now if I press F5, you'll see what will happen is the Wormy game is now running on my computer. So I can press a key to play, and it's a bit like a snake game. So I use the arrows to control the worm, and I go and try and catch the red fruit. I've just missed it. Okay. Trying to play a game and do a webinar at the same time. Just a little bit too taxing for my tiny little brain, but here we go. So you can see how I'm playing the game at the moment. Now, if I stop the game like this, actually close it. I can go to the source code for that, And here, where it says FPS equals 15, I can change it to 150. And now I can ask you, what effect do you think that will have on the game? So could you use the chat just to type in, what effect do you think? It says FPS, three letters there. It was 15. I've now changed to 150. You type in the chat, what do you think is going to happen? Oh, somebody said it's gone quiet. It might have been because the microphone was, I moved it further away. So the microphone's closer. So I'm asking you to tell me, what's going to happen when I change the FPS to 150? I've changed it to 150. So some people are saying it's going to increase the frame rate, and some people are saying it's going to make the speed of the game increase. So if I press F5 now, it will ask me to save it, and then I can test it just to see. Whoa! Suddenly, I don't know if you can see because the microphone's in the way, but it's going very, very fast. And if I press a key to play, oh, right. Okay, so you can see the game is going really, really fast. And that really is the kind of the essence of that workshop and how it runs. And what happens is, as the workshop goes on, you show them a variety of other games. And then you ask them to make changes to other games and make predictions and test out their predictions. And you've now got a link to those resources, so you can try that yourself. Now, some of the questions that you've just sent to me are, you're asking, assume that somebody is at a beginner level. No, the book doesn't assume that, but this actual lesson activity that I've planned allows for that. And I've actually got the source code for the game as well that you can click on, and you can see that just there. You would copy that into Idle, paste it, save it, all that kind of stuff. So it's actually a really, really enjoyable workshop to run. And the teacher who was running it, Mr. Grundy, he said it was a bit tricky just to begin with, to point, just because of the way we'd got the files configured. It was a bit bumpy at the beginning, but once the children had realized where the games were and they could make changes, there was a lot of creativity. And I liked the way he was using, you can see in the photographs, he was using whiteboards for the children to, like, here, this girl on the right, we had the driver and navigator. The girl on the right's making predictions and they're writing them on the whiteboard, and then they're testing the predictions out on the laptop. I did call in and visit that workshop at one point, and I don't know, it was. Here we go. Look, makes the squirrels go faster. And there was a real nice bubbly atmosphere in the class, as you could tell that they were really engaging with it. So that was the third workshop. Yep, hacking this pie game. We ran another workshop which we call Hack for Good. And some of you, if you've been on previous webinars I've done, you may have seen that. It involves things like teaching children how web pages are constructed, but then how you can modify elements in the web pages. And I used this with a class last week, and you should have seen their faces, because there's a link to a news story which kind of alarms people when they see it the first time if they've never seen it before, which is this proposal that the government are putting through that schools are now going to remain open all year, so there will no longer be any school holidays. And this is going to save parents money because it means they won't have to take their children on holiday anymore. And I showed this to a class last week on Tuesday, and you should have seen their faces. Until I pointed out other things, like that Obama is going to be captaining the England team, and that they've discovered alien life forms on the Philae comet, and then they start to realize that actually I've done something. So the other workshop, which is the Hack for Good one. And then the one that I actually led on the day was the Python celebrity chatbot, in which I going right back to basics. We start off with a blank editor and we start typing things in and we see what happens. And that was perhaps not as much fun, with a big emphasis on problem solving and all that. So they were the five workshops that happened during the day. And now you can see, if you click on that there, you've got pictures you can have a look at. In the evening, we ran the family hack jam. So the family hack jam. So we have lots of families come along, and teenagers of all different ages. Some of them came from the school, some of them came from other schools. It was actually a school trip came along as well. Can you hear me okay? I'm just a bit worried. Nobody's typing anything to the chat. Have you all left the room? So somebody type something in if you can hear me. Great. Okay. So the point of a family hack jam is to bring a whole community of people together. And they were all solving problems and teams, and we gave out prizes. We had about 60 people there all together, and we had judges judging the things that they'd made. It was like a hack day, but it just happened in 3 hours. And they had to build a game in Scratch, something to do with Eccles and Eccles cakes. And then at the end of the evening, what we did was, if I quick go through some of the pictures, and we had children of all ages. We had 6 and 7 year olds and 17 year olds. At the end of the evening, I put all the prizes together in one big space. So we can go and find a picture of the prizes. Coming up from around about now. Okay, and we had mini teachers going on as well, where people were giving each other skills workshops. And so all the prizes were on the floor, and the winning teams got to come down and choose their prizes from the assembled collection of prizes. And there's some of our winners. So some people had a fantastic. Well, I think they all had a good time, actually. And they're that school now, they're talking about how they can have future events of that. That was the Friday evening. And on the Saturday, we held a raspberry jam. Okay, so that link's not working. I need to go back and figure it out. So the raspberry jam, we ran two classrooms during the day. We had we called it a baby pie workshop. So it was, how do you set up your Raspberry Pi? How do you get it out of the box? What do you do with it? How do you build games in Scratch? And then we added like an intermediate advanced workshop, hacking Minecraft using Python. And then we had, it was a lovely thing. I wonder if I find that photograph. We had a boy called Jacob who came along. He's just sat in the back of that photograph, and he brought his Raspberry Pi along. And there was a man called Mark, and slightly older than myself, and he had a Raspberry Pi, but he'd never actually got his Raspberry Pi working. So 11-year-old Jacob was able to show 40-ish-year-old Mark how to set up his Raspberry Pi. So there's lots of people helping each other on the day, and I've put a YouTube video out there. I'll put a link in it later on. You can actually watch, do a little tour of that. So why am I telling you about all of this? Well, because really, if I can persuade you, I'd love you to come along to one of our jam-packed events. I've just listed another few over the last couple of days. These are coming up. We've got some happening based in Darlington in January. So we've got three there. We've got Hack to the Future, the Family Hack Jam, and the Raspberry Jam. So on the Friday the 9th of January, if you can get out of your school to come to Darlington for the day, you can see me teaching 90 children in one big space, and we'll be trying out lots of different events and activities all around programming and computing. Or if that's too far north, we're going to be in Stourbridge on the 31st of January. These are all free to come along. I've got the date there. I need to change it. It's actually the 30th of January. And we've got raspberry jams. And maybe if it's not too far away, you might want to bring some children from your school along on a trip. We're going to be in Leeds in February. And we've got loads of other places. Oh, we'll go to Mansfield as well in Nottinghamshire. That's in April. And there's a load more. That's the update on where we are with Jam Packed. Now, you probably know this because unless you've been hiding under a rock, that this week is the US Our Code Week, or they just call it Our Code.
I'm just gonna answer Cheryl's
question
moment.
Oh dear, dear.
My sound
sometimes
sometimes
goes a bit
goes a
like
bit like
robot,
robot,
like a
like
cyberman.
So
They
they
sent me a
sent me a
tweet
tweet
telling me that
telling me
sound
that
is
sound
dumb,
is dumb.
dumb.
Yeah.
So
So
if I
if
slow
I slow
down for a
down for a
moment,
moment,
the
I think the
sounds might
sounds
come
might
back.
come back.
Do I
Do
sound
I
like a
sound like a
cyberman now?
cyberman now?
This just
This just
happens
happens
sometimes.
sometimes.
Hello, how do I
How do I
sound
sound
now?
now?
Okay. Sometimes I'll just give it a few moments. It picks up and it's okay. Hello. Oh no. Okay, I'll have a drink while I'm waiting for the sound to catch up. Oh, it's fixed. Oh, great. Okay. So I'll come back to Hour of Code in a moment. So, Cheryl, you asked what age it would be appropriate for. So, Hack to the Future takes place during a school day. And if you want to bring children from your school along to one of these, it's not impossible, but it's just a bit more problematic because it may be that the school, like the one in Darlington, they figured out we can fit 90 children into this big space and probably no more. So if you wanted to bring along another 90 from your school, then that would cause us problems. But if you're going to bring along two or three, we might be able to squeeze you in. That's during the school day. So like I say, it's not impossible, but we have to negotiate and try and figure that out. Now, the Friday evening and the Saturday events, totally bring along as many children as you can. We've run these events where we can have up to 200 people taking part. So far, we've had about 60 taking part, so that means that's 140 places that are not being filled. If you don't really want to be organizing a trip on a Friday evening, there are other ways you can do it, which is you can tell them you're organizing a trip, but that they're going to have to sort out their own transport. So maybe some parents can run like a convoy together where they go along, but and you might even bring your own family along to one of these things. I realize it's a Friday evening and we've all got better things to do, but there's a big emphasis on entertainment at these events. So you could sit at home and watch I'm a Celebrity or X Factor or something else like this, but you'd probably actually have a, well, of course, no, probably. You'd definitely have a much better experience at this Friday night or Saturday events. So we're mostly going to be just slightly south of Scotland, between the east and west coast, and down as far as Stourbridge is the furthest south we're going to go. That's just slightly south of Birmingham. But absolutely, if you can bring your own kids along. So we've had, somebody actually had a baby on Saturday. So no, they didn't have a baby like while the event was on, but they brought a baby along with them. It was about 6 months old or something. The baby just sat there comfortably, didn't really get much out of the Minecraft session. I think it was a bit below the baby's level, but there was children from 4 or 5 years up. In fact, if you look at the YouTube video, you'll see it's just a really nice kind of family-centered event. So the Hour of Code, lots of organizations like Code Academy and Tinker and Grok Learning and Microsoft, they've put together all of these resources that you can use with your classes this week to teach the Hour of Code. Now, I'm not taking you to the Hour of Code website with this link I've just clicked on. This is, I woke up on Thursday morning and I knew there was just no way I was going to be able to teach in the condition I was in. So, thankfully, I had already prepared a list of like my selection of Hour of Code activities. The Hour of Code website looks fantastic. It's got loads of videos and whizzy little animations and things all over it. But I just wanted the Thursday. I had four lessons on Thursday and I wasn't in a single one of them. I just wanted a colleague. It could have been a supply teacher. It was a supply teacher. I just wanted to be able to say to a class, look, here, choose one of these and work your way through it. So what I've done is I've looked through all of the Hour of Code activities and tried to find the ones that I thought would cause the least issues or problems to my classes. And they're all browser based. And so if we have a look at this one here. So Tinker, build the space zombies game. You click on there and it takes you to something. So whether you're going to get your children in your school to go through to the Hour of Code website this week, or whether you're just going to direct them to certain ones, there's a whole variety of things in there that you can send them to. So, where? Oh, I forgot what I was supposed to be looking for. But you can see they're graded. So, we've got Candy Quest for beginners. We'd probably be looking for something intermediate if it's secondary school. And then you have to build your hero and you work through them. Okay, that's not what I thought it was going to be. But Okay, anyway, so Code Combat, there's another one there. So you, at your leisure, you go through those. They stay up there all year, and they don't get refreshed really until you need them. That's when they get refreshed or they get changed. But there's a whole load of things there, and I just said to my classes, just try them out and let me know which one you liked. And you could see some were very popular and others were less popular. So all I'm doing at this point is just to tell you that I've gone through and have found some, and if you found any that you think are particularly good as well, add them in there, or tell me and I'll add them in. So that's the hour of code bit, which brings us up to 6:30, which means I'm bang on time to talk about teaching computing GCSE. Sorry, I got a little bit excited then because I normally overrun in the first session, first part. So last week, I didn't get time to go through it, but I got a question from Jamie. And Jamie was asking a question, which was kind of, how do you get them just to keep going and pushing? So Jamie says he teaches in an all-girls school, and the biggest challenge he's got is getting the girls to be more inquisitive and demanding of their own programs. He wants to create an environment where they enjoy the continuous improvement of their programs, even if it means the program breaks or fails in some way. Except they're quite scared of failure. It's like they've been conditioned into thinking that failure is bad. So typically you'll give them a scenario, a problem to solve, they solve it and then they stop. And he has to keep prompting them to think about how it could be extended. He wants them to start thinking about this for themselves, but they seem reluctant. So this was last time, this was on the 24th of November, and I one night was scratching my head. I knew I had a lesson observation coming up, and I thought, why don't I try and answer Jamie's question in my performance management lesson observation? And that's what I tried to do. So what I'm going to take you to now on this link here. So on the 3rd of December, it was on Wednesday, I had a lesson observation, and this takes you to my Year 10 GCSE computing class. So I wished I was able to tell you now the feedback I've received from this lesson, but I haven't received it yet, so I hope to update you in the next lesson. Now, a couple of things I'm going to mention. So some of these are kind of like things that you probably know already, like little tips that we can trade. I decided the lesson the night before or whatever, I think I need a different seating plan for the lesson tomorrow because I probably should have changed it a couple of weeks before the lesson plan was, they say the lesson observation was coming up, but I just decided to have another lesson observation, another lesson plan, seating plan, sorry, for that lesson. So I reorganized all of the seating, and I am so glad I did that because I started to, well, I'll tell you in a moment. So if we skip past lesson 27, let's look, I'm not in today, can't be with you, try one of these hour of code activities. So all my lesson notes, my classes, they're used to now referring to these. They know that's where our lesson notes are. Just use the chat just to let me know if you're still there, you're still tuned in, everything's working okay, because you've all gone very quiet. Looks like about 20 in the moment. Great. So here are my learning outcomes for my lesson observation. So in my school, we have two formal lesson observations every year, which is part of our appraisal or performance management. And I'm the head of computing. We're called principal teachers in our school, the heads of department. And I was being observed by my line manager, who's a member of the senior leadership team, called Mary, and to her judgment was being validated by our head teacher. So I've got two members of the senior leadership team, including my head teacher, observing me. So my added pressure. And here's what I said: so accurately predict the outcome of an algorithm, identify syntax errors. So that's something I want them to be able to develop in the lesson. Define and use arrays as appropriate when solving problems. And understand and use iteration. Now, the first one of those three, they should be fairly competent at now. They're year 10, they have five lessons a fortnight, and I've been drilling syntax errors into them since lesson one, really. And you can go back and you can check that because all the notes are there. So it was the second two, and I didn't really feel that we were going to perfect them in this particular lesson, but I want it, you know, it's such a work in progress. So when the class came in, I had them standing in silence as they normally do, and I said, right, got a new seating plan today. Now, what I'd actually done, I've based my seating plan, this latest one, on their latest test scores. If I could come here and show you their test scores. Now, you won't actually be able to see their actual test score. Oh, there we are. So I know if I unhide these columns here, I know what test scores that they've all got. And what I decided to do, I was going to seat them together simply put, in a clever manner. That means that somebody might be sat next to somebody who maybe scored 10% more than them in the test, but you wouldn't have somebody who scored 80% in the test and somebody who scored 10% sat next to each other. It's like in a stepped kind of arrangement, so that, and I also construed the seating plan so the person who was sat on the right. So if I pick a pair and show you. Wrong document. So, for example, in this pair here, Joe's test score was approximately 10% better than Jasmine's. James's test score was approximately 10% better. So the person on the right slightly stronger than the person on the left in terms of the test scores. Because I then wanted in the lesson, if you imagine I'm right-handed, so I think that my right hand is stronger than my left hand or more accurate. So that's how the seating plan is organized at the moment. But you could have two kind of A star candidates sat close together. Well, it'd be more like an A star and an A. You could have a B and a C, but you wouldn't have an A and an E candidate sat next to each other. So they're in their seats, stood up, whatever. And then the next thing is, I said, now, on the board in front of you, you can see an example of some Python code. Okay, so there's the example there. Now, you might be able to spot some errors in it straight away, but that's not what I'm asking you to do. What I want you to do is imagine that there are no errors in this. Now, people at home, listeners at home, what audience, I'm going to ask you the same question. What do you predict if there was no errors in it and it was all perfect? What do you predict would happen when I execute this? So I'm going to pause and let you type into the chat. What do you predict would happen if I execute this code? So I can see some people are now typing in. What do you predict if there's no errors and this is all absolutely perfect without syntax errors? What do you predict? What would be the behavior? Chris, I'd agree there are some syntax errors, but what we're trying to do is we're trying to predict what would this code actually do when executed. So Christine, you're saying it'll either be heads or tails. And somebody in the class did actually say that was the first answer we had. And I was being very careful to look at their faces because as somebody put their hand up and said, so let's just, so Maria, yeah, Maria, you say it's going to say heads or tails. But when I looked at Maz's face at the same time, Maz's face kind of looked a bit puzzled, like he didn't agree with Maria's answer. I said, so Maz, you don't totally agree with Maria. What is it you want to say? He said, well, it will choose heads or tails, but it's probably going to pick tails more often than heads. I was like, yes, great. So by drilling down, I was able to get, and we were able to go around the class. And what I didn't mention actually now was, I didn't just get them to shout it out straight away or just put their hand up straight away. I got them to think about it, then have a discussion with their partner, and through having a discussion with their partner to try and get the best possible answer. So the discussion happened, and then they were revealing to me. So somebody else was saying, oh, it would do it forever. Somebody else said, no, it would only do it once. And this is where I said, right, well, what I could do now is I could make the corrections and test it out. But you're going to test out your predictions in just a few moments. Now, the next question is, there are some errors in there, and I want you to try and identify where the errors are with your partner. You're going to have a discussion now, and you're going to tell me what you would do to correct those syntax errors. So this is now, this bit's quite nice for a lesson observation because it means you can stop back for a moment, have a look around, what's going on. Because if you've got a lesson observation where it's all on you and it's all very didactic, you talking to the class, it doesn't give you time to stop and pause and think about what's going on. So some of you have now started telling me what you think the errors are, and that's kind of what happened then in the class. So I'd ask three or four to identify an error, and I said, it doesn't have to be in order. You can go to the last line or the middle line or whatever. And so we've got incorrect quote marks, six errors. Now, I think six is about the number I counted. So let's see, just to put you out of your misery. Now, this one here, bit of a banana skin in terms of planning a lesson. This one really caused them a lot of problems because they wanted to tell me it was input, not input. But actually, I have to copy this because these are my like live lesson notes and paste it below. It was actually import random. And the other thing I was careful to do as well was I didn't put these in idle. Let me just drop this down a few lines so that you can see it all on the same page. Because I knew if I put it in idle, it was going to use color syntax highlighting to highlight the errors. You're really good. Yeah, Mike and Deirdre and Chris, you're on fire. You're spotting all of the. Oh, Christine's seen a seventh one. So, but I'm just guessing, you've been quite quiet on the chat so far, and now there's loads of messages coming through. So I'm guessing that the level of engagement, because maybe I've kind of still talking waffle waffle in the background, but it's like a challenge. Oh, if Christine's seen seven and I can only see five, where's the sixth and seventh one? But nobody said she's right. So, I could go through and do all of them. I remember I talked to so. And again, as the children give me their answers, I was trying to insert technical language. So somebody said, coin sides, coin flips, coin fl like they need to be named. Oh, you're saying that the variables should be consistently named. Oh, well done. So I was trying to do that, try and you get them to force them to use the correct terminology. Now, there was an error here, which one of you has already spotted. This was not a deliberate error. This was one that accidentally happened, which is when you use Google Documents, it tries to put in these like little printmaker quotes, and really it should be these block quotes here. So that was one. Now, I don't. Oh, Carol, well done, Carol Lomax. You spotted there's a glyph in there. Now, a glyph is a character that visually appears like another. We've actually got two different characters there. We've got a one and an L. And if I was using idle, it would have come up black rather than orange. So there's another one I've corrected. There's another one. Yep, Tony, well spotted. When we have an assignment like that, we just have a single equals, not a double equals. And is that it? Yeah, capital P on the print. Okay, I think that might be it. But oh. There's a colon missing from here. Some people were telling me that the true should be lowercase, but actually it is uppercase. And then the other thing, some people said, it's not a syntax error, they said if you remove one of the tails, it'll simulate a coin toss because it will then be, there's an apostrophe missing. Well done. I've lost count now. Oh, no, put the then ones in. So, we've now got the corrected one. Now, I didn't actually show them the corrected code in the lesson because I allowed them to tell me, I said, right now, here's what's going to happen next. So, driver, oh, sorry, I didn't tell you. Drivers, you're the people on the right in every pair. We have a driver on the right, and the navigator is going to be on the left. So, I left something out here from my lesson, but I'll come on to that in a minute. So, what's going to happen next is in pairs, I'm going to ask you to correct the errors. That's the first challenge. And it's the objective is to create a coin flip simulator that has a fair chance of returning heads or tails. And then you're going to test it so you know it executes without errors to see how fair it is. So, okay, go off. So it was the driver navigator. You're going to have 5 minutes each. But again, what I did was I used a timer on my phone. But I didn't give the driver 5 minutes the first time round. I only gave the driver 4 minutes. So that meant the stronger person is doing the typing stuff in while the navigator's telling them what to do. And then, okay, as the 4 minutes was up, but I said it was five, okay, and we swap over. So you either move the mouse and keyboard, or you swap seats, and now you've got another 5 minutes, except this time, the weaker of the two, who's now driving, actually gets 6 minutes. So it means all the time, every time we do one, like we do a full rotation, the person on the right who's stronger is actually doing 3 more minutes of instruction compared to the weaker of the two, who does 3 minutes less of the instruction and 3 minutes more action. So then I paused them all for a moment. They were all getting onto different stages. And I did a little bit of a demonstration of using lists in Python. So I did something like this. Let me go and find idle. A little test for you coming up. I hope your fingers on buzzers ready for this. So the first thing I did was I just said A equals 1. B, oh, I'm going to type in A, it returns 1. And I said, I type in B, what does it return? And they put their hands up and everything, 2. I was like, no, what are you doing? So, okay, why do you think it's 2? And they said, because A is 1. I went, okay, let's have a look. Oh, B is not defined. Oh, and then you could see that, oh yeah. So I said, let's say B equals 2. What's C equal to? You know, so that, so you've got there. Why not use the weaker student first as they may find the more obvious mistakes? Yeah, Norman, I you know, as I was just telling you then, I thought, why did I not do it that way around? But that's just the way I did it. It would actually make more sense to do it the way that you're saying. So then the next thing is I said, this time I'm going to make a list. And in this list, I'm going to put some numbers. So I have 11, 12, 13, and I've now created a list. If I type in A this time, it returns a list, where B just returns a single value. This time, I'm going to ask it to return a certain position from the list, the oneth value from the list. So when I press enter, something is going to happen. Tell your partner, whisper. I think it's going to say 11. Oh, I think it's going to say 12. So they're all whispering to each other. And I say, are we ready? And I was just about to press enter. And I hung on for a moment. And I looked at the people who were observing me at the back of the room. And I could see they were going. And it was like this moment of silence. And I said, oh, I should press the enter key. I just wanted to see, you know. And it returns 12. And some were going, what? Why is it doing 12? And we had all this like discussion. And I think this is the caretaker. He's going to come in and tell me to lock up. He always comes in this time. Anyway, so, or else it's somebody dragging chains behind them. So then, right, everybody now should be able to predict what's going to happen next. And we press enter. And then it was that. So, going back, I can hear him, but I can't see him. So going back to our lesson notes. Oh, hello, Stephen.
Hello.
Hello. You took me by surprise then. Yeah, everything's switched off apart from the stuff I'm using. Right. And there's nobody else in school but us chickens at the moment. Yeah. And you're going to go and I'm going to lock the gates after me.
Okay.
Great. Okay. Yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow. So then there was the other thing, which is challenge 2. I said, try adding this into your script to see what happens. I don't know if you saw, I tweeted this the other day. This is my new little toy in Python. This is so cool. So I got to Python. Where am I over here? Anybody used it yet? My little toy I found the other day. You type that into Python and you press enter and something really cool happens. Have we done it already? I'm asking you now, not the class, not the make me leave class in my head. Have we tried it yet? No! Oh! And I'm going to be really mean and I'm not actually going to show you what's going to happen. Because that's what I do. You know, I'm trying to get people excited and interested in it. So, anyway, so it says, put it into your... You really want me to tell you, don't you? Yeah, you really want me to show you what's going to happen. So there we are. And I'm not! I'm a real rotter. I'm not going to show you. You thought I was then for a moment. So it does actually do something very, very neat. But I asked them, come on, try this yourself. Now, I'm talking you through my lesson observation. And you might be thinking, why is he doing this? Because Jamie had asked me in a previous thing, he said, all girls, they're worried about failure, they're quite scared. I give them a problem to solve, they solve it straight away. Maybe what you can do is break the problem down into little stages. So this is what I've done with this particular thing, and I don't know if you can see where I'm heading with all of this, but this little bit here does something really, really neat. It does do something really, really neat. When you discover it, okay, right, I'm chickening out, I'm gonna show you. So it was one of those things, in one of the first webinars I did, somebody said, how do you, I'll tell you what, I'll show you the answer. So when you press enter, oh, there's a bit of a lag. It's not happened on your screen yet. So I pressed enter about 3 seconds ago. Come on, wake up. It's still not display. Oh, there we are. So I can go A, B, A plus B. I don't know if I can do that now because a different data type. One's a data structure, the data type. But if I put in that line again and press enter, it's so cool what it does. I wanted this for ages and I just never realized how simple it was. Watch. Now you see it. Type this in and it disappears. That is so cool. Okay, maybe you've not done enough programming in Python in the shell to realize why that's so cool. But when you're trying to demonstrate things to your class, it is very, very handy. And you know what? If you create a function, it's even more cool. Look, you say def. So def is to make a function. CLS, which is going to be clear screen. I have to give it brackets like this and a colon. Do I need a colon? Yeah, and then I put that little line in there and I press enter. So I've now created a function called CLS. So look, somebody doesn't get it. So look, blah, 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 blah. Your screen's all full of all this rubbish. I'll wait for a moment. There's a bit of a lag between me saying something and then appearing on your screen. So you've got your shell full of all this rubbish and you want to clear it. You just type in CLS, open close brackets, and watch, just the fonts, I just click my fingers and it just works. Watch, enter. Whoa! Yay! Run around the room in circles. Okay. Yeah, and you can look, you can still scroll up and all your old stuff is still there. All it does is it just puts in 100 blank lines and clears your shell really, really quickly. But it adds actually a nice, neat feature into the coin toss thing, because the last thing you want to see with a coin toss is heads, 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 tails, tails, heads. So it clears the screen every time you run it, if you put it in the right place. So then we move on to challenge number three, because some of them thought that they put it in the right place, but they weren't getting the right kind of results. So challenge three, modify your program so it can ask the user to guess heads or tails. And then there's another one, modify it to skew the results. Well, you should be able to figure that out now. Then build a rock, paper, scissors. So all of these problems, they don't necessarily have a perfect solution as you go along. Okay. So, I just dropped the mic then. So that was, we didn't really get to challenges 5 and 6. I think a couple of pairs got to challenge number 4. And I have them tomorrow and we're going to pick up from there, from where we had the lesson observation. So I think what I need to do is I need to cut this bit out here because I don't want my class to see that bit tomorrow. And I'm going to put that into our document somewhere like about here. So I had loads more stuff to mention, which I'm going to have to race through really quickly now so I can finish at 7 o'clock. So that was my lesson plan. I'm waiting to find out. In our school this year, lesson observations, a new big focus is assessment. So we're being told when we're observing somebody teach a lesson, we need to spend at least 15 minutes of the lesson looking at assessment and how does assessment inform the learning and progress and that kind of thing. So they did spend what seemed like a long amount of time looking at my books and passing them backwards and forwards. So I probably got, I don't know if I'm going to get a slap on the wrist. I mean, I was up to, they had the right amount of feedback and everything, but I'm probably going to get some useful suggestions about what we need to do in terms of our feedback to pupils. Now, at the beginning of tonight's webinar, I mentioned Susan Bays, and Susan was very, very kind. She put a message on Facebook the other day. So there's a Facebook page, I can put it in here, which is mostly OCR GCSE computing kind of questions. And lots of people are sharing lots of problems and solutions on there. And Susan put this really nice message. She said she'd had a lesson observation that had been graded outstanding. And she said she'd built the lesson around some of the activities that I'd been sharing in one of these webinars. And she was really grateful. And I asked her if she'd share the resources. So if you want to find out what resources she used, you just need to sign into computing at school and you'll be able to access them yourself. So I'm just logging in now. And good old Susan for sharing. So it's like a PowerPoint and binary to deanery starter. So that's great. So thank you, Susan. And if anybody, so these podcasts and webinars and all these things, these are being provided free because the DfE and the Raspberry Pi Foundation are paying for grants to fund them. If you're actually using any of these resources and you're finding that they've helped you in any way, please let me know because I can then go back to the DfE and the Raspberry Pi Foundation and say, look, this is actually a useful resource. Some of you haven't really filled in many of my evaluation forms. I've got an evaluation form. I always try and send it out afterwards just to let me know how useful the session was. Now, I think I'm going to have to bump little man till next time. So I'm just going to write the word bump there. I think we have one more session next week. You can sign up for that. That's on the 15th of December. So I think I'll make that little man computing one. And then we have one on the 22nd December. That's like a couple of days before Christmas Day, actually. So, oh, I need to go back to my previous. So, who did that ask for? Little man computing. But it's simply called Susan, but I don't think Susan's on tonight, so I'll tell her to wait till Christmas. Now, there was a couple of questions that came up in the last session. One of them was, I've been talking about using homework books, and there's 5 points that I use to mark these. So I've now linked those online. I've shared them on the Computing at School site. So it's a sheet that you can download that tells you how. You go back and look at one of the webinars previously, and you'll see. And then Nikki, she says she needs help with OCR A453 Maths Quiz 2 and 3. Now, I'm really, really got my hands tied here because of the rules and regulations around these. I can't actually share them with you because if I share solutions to these online, how do I know that you are definitely a teacher and it's going to compromise the whole thing for everybody? What I have done is I've linked to some discussions on the Computing at School site that I've been following myself, and I would recommend you go and read some of them. One of my kind of heroes in this, who helped me a bit, is Mark Clarkson. He's actually said he's staying away from the maths quiz, but I'm not. I'm sticking with the maths quiz, as it's maths that we teach, not math. And one thing I have been doing with my class, I go back up to the top of my lesson notes and all that. It says programming. So these are my lesson notes from my Year 10 GCSE computing class. I have a link here to the programming requirements for the GCSE specification. And what I keep doing is I keep referring back to elements of these with my classes. So iteration, conditionals, something about arrays in here somewhere. There we are. My kind of destination that I've got planned is by the middle of February, by the time we get to the half-term holiday, I want my class to be fairly competent with all of these. And that's what I'm planning to do. I'm planning to have my classes all ready. Now, I do know that task three is quite a challenge. And some people have said that they find the file management, I've actually found file management quite fun to teach. So I'm going to make a note to myself that file management in Python, I find it quite fun actually. And you can have a, so I'm going to do that in a future one. Now, it's Coming up to 7 o'clock. I'm just gonna have a quick scroll through the chat to see if there's any questions that came up that I've not answered. And if you've got one or two questions now, I'll do my best. So Mark Clarkson has said he's looking at the speed trap one instead. I don't know why I dismissed that one. Maybe I need to go back and look at that. So if anybody types in any questions now, like an agony aunt, I'll try and answer them as the best of my ability. Yes, so file handling, I've put that down for next time. I also, somebody was saying on, there's a Facebook page, and I kind of stayed away from Facebook for a while, but I've been using the Facebook page myself recently, and I've tried to answer a few questions on there for people. And I did actually answer one of those with some examples of the file management one. Let's see what other questions are coming up. Any more questions? Could we mark some coursework together? Okay, so to mark some coursework together, yes, we'll do a little bit of this. Now I have some coursework from last, like, since 2012 that is no longer a live assignment, so we could do a little bit of that. However, if you, I would really recommend, of course I would, that you try and come along on one of the GCSE computing days that I do. Now, it's hidden at the moment in this document because I need to put some new dates in, but I've agreed some dates for March, May, June, and July where I will be doing exactly that sort of thing. So typically what happens is five or six teachers come and spend a day with me. They get to come and watch me teach a GCSE computing lesson, my year 10 class. We complete a GCSE control assessment and we get to mark some coursework together. So Mike came on a course a bit like that last year, but the course has developed on a bit where we actually do a lot of marking coursework. So I'll do a little bit in a future one, but to kind of keep your appetite fresh, we won't do, well, we wouldn't be able to do all of one in an hour anyway. So that's something for the future. So here's my future wish list. Okay, so it's just after 7. I guess some of you need to go and catch up with your families and see what's been going on. If you're in any of those areas I mentioned, like Darlington, Leeds, oh, we've got one in Manchester coming up as well. Yeah, Leeds, Craig. Craig, did you actually come to the Raspberry Jam? Because we had a Craig came to the Raspberry Jam. I know that Carol did. Carol Lomax. Yeah. Carol got to meet Jacob, and she, in fact, Carol helped Jake out. Yeah, it was great. Yeah. So there's going to be one at the Manchester Communication Academy, which I think will be in February. I've got to list an awful lot more dates. We've got pretty much 2 a month now till the end of March. That's the thing, Carol's saying that Jacob was great. The thing that is so lovely about something like a Raspberry Jam is, you no longer have these kind of boundaries like, oh, he's 11 years old, so he can't really be a teacher because he's, and I don't in any way say that Jacob was a teacher, but it for a day, at least in his head, he thought he was a teacher. So yeah, Lewis, we're in Stourbridge on the 30th of January and the 31st. So Stourbridge, if you Google Map it, you'll find it's just slightly outside. And we've got Mansfield in April. That's slightly northeast of the Midlands. So we're at Pedmore Technology College. So please come along. Try and get some time out of school if you can. Okay. Thanks, Mike. So I'm going to say goodbye now and stop the recording. So the recording is going to stop about now. Thank you very much, everybody.